afternoon, everyone. I need to appreciate them. We have been presenting Matisse's topic, tag with boxes for automatic email generation, and my advice is to send out the thesis. In this thesis, we have solved the problem of how to automate the events based on the geographic location using GPS. Our motivating application is to facilitate the data collection for lab experiments. So with the increasing number of vehicular application, it becomes necessary to collect huge amounts of data for doing the performance analysis. So we demonstrated our technique using the data collection process along the predefined route. We know initiating the data collection manually is a tedious task, and it is also prone to errors. The next motivating application was to automate the opening and the closing of barriers in the parking lots or toll booths. This prevents the long queues that could be formed in front of the barriers. We also try to automate this process. The third is the secure access to the doors of the buildings. This eliminates the need for the individual to carry keys or identity cards for accessing the doors. We have two related techniques. One is the virtual trip line concept. The other is the boundary detection technique. Here, the virtual trip lines is nothing but an imaginary line segment that is marking a geographical location, as shown in the figure. The blue lines represent the trip line. So for the data collection technique, on crossing the first trip line, we initiate the data collection process. And upon crossing the another trip line, we can stop the data collection process. However, in the presence of some hindrance along this route, and we have initiated the data collection. And with the hindrance, we have to take a detour from this route. And this will require an exclusive stopping of the event. So this requires a manual effort. Or we can also define multiple trip lines along all the deviations that are present. However, finding small deviations along this route becomes a tedious task. The other problem with this technique is due to the GPS error. When the GPS coordinates fall parallel to the road such that there occurs no intersection between the trip line and the GPS coordinates, then we might not detect the trip line. And this will lead to not initiating the data collection process, and hence we will lose huge amounts of data. The other is the boundary detection technique, which uses a Zigbee network and performs adaptive sampling of the received signal to get the accurate location of the device, of the target. So here, when the target approaches closer to the boundary, they increase the sampling rate, and when the target is away from the boundary, they have a lower sampling rate. This is because they wanted to save energy. In our system, we have the vehicle supplying the energy, and hence energy efficiency is not a very important factor. And this uses a Zigbee network, which requires an infrastructure setup. However, in our case, we use GPS, and hence the existing setup. For solving this problem, we propose chip box. Chip box is nothing but a rectangular box that is oriented towards geographic north and east directions. And this is defined using the diagonal coordinates x1, y1, and x2, y2. And the horizontal line is the width of the trip box, and the vertical line is the length of the trip box. We define the trip box in Google Earth and save it in KML format. Here, we use push pins to define the diagonal coordinates. This is because using a push pin would reduce the manual effort of hard coding the latitude and the longitude information in the file, and hence makes the system more dynamic and easier to use. And here we have shown a sample KML file. The tripbox.kml is the name of the file. and we have shown the definition of a pushpin. So here we can see all the latitude and the longitude information. We pass through this file to read the coordinates of the trip box. So how does the trip box work? So when the object enters into the trip box region, we trigger an event, and upon leaving the trip box, we trigger another event. So for our data collection process, we initiate the data collection process on entering into the trip box, and when we leave the trip box, we stop this process. So here, as we can see, when the car enters into the trip box region, it triggers a function called fn, and upon leaving the trip box, it triggers a function called fr. The fn and the fr functions are the user defined functions. So in our case, fn is nothing but start the data collection process, and fr is nothing but stop the data collection process. Our system consists of a laptop connected to a GPS connected to a laptop, and GPS forms the base of our system, and GPS receiver receives the location information from the satellites and stores it in the receiver buffer, and the GPSD process makes this received information available for all the above applications. And after defining the trip box in Google Earth, we export this file to the trip box library from the user program, and on receiving the location information from the GPS, the virtual trip box library tries to detect the trip box and triggers the event. Here we have shown a sample user code. This is written in Ruby. In order to use all the trip box library function, we first include the library, and the start function and the stop function represented here are just the user defined function. So in our case of data collection experiment, the start function represents the initiation of the data collection, and the stop function represents stopping the data collection process. We pass the tripbox.kml file to the library in order to read the information about the latitude and the longitude of the trip box. And here we have defined, tried to register all the trip boxes that we have defined. And here, as we can see, we have three trip boxes defined, which says that our system can handle multiple trip boxes. And we have defined the trip box with the ID of the trip box and the diagonal coordinates and their corresponding star fn and the fr functions that we mentioned previously. And finally, we call wait for trip boxes function, which actually detects the trip box and triggers the event. Here we have given a sample timeout value of 500 seconds. However, there is no limitation for this timeout value. There are two challenges that we faced due to the errors of the GPS. One is due to the oscillation of the GPS coordinates. So we have, when considering a scenario where a car would stop in front of a stop line, and say we have a boundary line coinciding with this stop line, then we can have some oscillations in the GPS, and we have repeated triggering of the events. So say we have the car approaching the boundary line, and we have first GPS coordinate inside the trip box which triggers the function in, and we have the next GPS coordinate outside the trip box triggering the fr function, and we have other coordinates inside the trip box which trigger the fr function. So this is the repeated triggering scenario. For solving this problem, we propose guard parameters. Guard parameters is nothing but the guard distance and the guard time. So here we have a minimum, so we say that the target has to cover a minimum distance in between the successive event triggers from the same trip box. So say for example, after triggering the fn function, we wait for the target to cross a minimum distance of guard distance before it can trigger an fr function. In this way, we can prevent the repeated event triggers. Guard time is nothing but the minimum time the target has to travel in between successive event triggers. we can see that the guard distance itself solves the problem of repeated event triggers. We just provide another option of using guard time.
So how do you choose a good value for guard distance?
We have performed experiments, so we will be saying how much should be the guard distance for different cases.
That depends on the size of the trick box and also how good your GPS readings are.
Yes. We show how much should be the guard distance later. So here, as we can see, we considered the same scenario of repeated triggering of events and explain how we prevent this problem. So initially, we check whether we are inside or outside the trick box, and we are inside the trick box first, and we check our previous state whether it is outside or not. Yes, it was outside, and hence we check if the guard flags are set. Initially, the guard flags are not set, and hence we trigger the function FL and set all the guard flags and store the information. Our next GPS coordinate is outside the trick box, so we pass through that side and we see whether our previous state was inside the trick box. Yes, it was inside, and hence we check if the guard flags are set. However, here we set the guard flags, so we just don't do anything. So now, having the next coordinate inside the trick box, we check the previous state of the previous state was outside. Since we didn't store any of the state information there, so we just pass through here and check the guard distance and the guard time. In case if they have crossed, then we would reset the flags. Otherwise, we just receive another GPS coordinate and repeat this process. So the next challenge is the skipping of the trip box. So this happens when the trip box encloses a very small region, such that there is no GPS sample inside this region. So this leads to the possibility of missing the trip box. So our experimental goals were to determine the probability of skipping the trip box for a vehicle traveling at different speeds, using the dimensions of the trip box, and to find the effects of the GPS sampling rate on the necessary bit parameter of the trip box, and to determine the guard distance for a trip box in order to prevent repeated triggering of the event. So the minimum length of the trip box is nothing but the vertical error of the GPS. So here it is represented by this. Here it is represented by that measure, and here the vertical error is nothing but the deviation of the GPS coordinate along the either side of the globe. The minimum length is measured as the perpendicular distance of the coordinate from the median of the road, and we conducted this experiment over a very small range in the longitude of about 0.00050, and we used the data collected for the partner project over a period of 40 days, and it was on a 0.4 mile stretch of a road with four lanes. So on evaluating the minimum length, we calculated the deviation of the GPS from the center of the road. The car has, so here this graph has number of data points on the y-axis and distance measured from the center on x-axis, and we measured the average width of the road as approximately 16 meters for a four-lane road. And here the car has traveled, here we have a peak at -4. This is because the car has traveled mostly on the left lane of the road, and from this graph we can see that for not missing, say for the first scenario that we said, the possibility of missing a trip line, we can say that if the trip line is maximum of -22 to +22, which is nothing but totally of length 44, then we might not miss the trip line. And even this is the same case with trip box. The trip box needs to be minimum of 22 meters measured from the center of the road. and on estimating the minimum length of the trip box, for a given probability of the crossing the trip box, we found the CDF of the distance. And here, as we can see on the graph, we have the probability percentage on the y-axis and the distance measured from the center on x-axis. And for 95% chances of crossing the trip box, the minimum length needs to be 16 meters measured from the center of the trip. And we calculated the minimum width of the trip box, and this is nothing but the horizontal error of the GPS. And horizontal error is nothing but the displacement of the GPS coordinates along the direction of motion of the target. And we measured this minimum length as the perpendicular distance of the GPS coordinate, which triggers the FN function inside the trip box from the entry edge. So we plotted for evaluating the minimum width of the trip box, we plotted the graph for varying speeds and the distance, and we are able to find that as the speed increases, we have increase in the distance from the entry edge of the trip box. This is because we know the speed is directly proportional to the distance, and with the distance between the two successive GPS coordinates increases with increase in speed. And hence, we see this scenario. And for estimation of the minimum width of the trip box for a given speed and the probability of crossing the trip box, we see that for a speed less than 20 miles per hour, we have a 95% chances of crossing the trip box when the width is 2 meters. However, for a speed less than 60 miles per hour, we have a 95% chances of crossing the trip box when the width is 13 meters. And this graph shows the probability of crossing the trip box for different speeds. And the probability is plotted in the y-axis and the distance is in the x-axis. And yeah, we have measured it for speeds varying from 0 to 20, 20 to 40, and till 80 miles per hour. And we also conducted experiments by varying the sampling rate. We know the sampling rate affects the horizontal error of the GPS. So we varied the sampling rate from 5 hertz to 1 hertz and conducted the experiment for calculating the minimum width of the trip box. We calculated the displacement of the GPS coordinate that triggers the FN function for the speed interval of 0 to 30 miles per hour from the entry edge. And the effects of sampling rate, as we can see, in this graph we have plotted the probability in y-axis and distance measured from the ideal position or the entry edge of the trip box. And we varied for the sampling rate from 5 hertz to 1 hertz. We have a better probability of crossing the trip box with 5 hertz sampling rate comparing to the rest. And with minimum width as 2.5 meters and sampling rate as 5 hertz, we have 90% reliability of crossing the trip box. However, with 1 hertz sampling rate, we have only 75% reliability of crossing the same trip box.
Can you give an example on the whiteboard there why, how the sampling rate affects the crossing of the trip box?
Draw
a trip box in it.
Okay.
So he's too low, he might miss the trip box.
Yeah.
If the trip box is not large enough.
So, in 1 second, for the 5 hertz sampling rate, we have 5 GPS samples. So, say this is the trip box, and we have 5 samples. Then we have 5 samples in one second. And say this is the distance as we enter the trip box from this direction. this is the minimum width calculation distance from the entry edge. However, for 1 hertz sampling rate, we have the first GPA sample here and the next GPA sample here. So this also leads to the possibility of missing the two probes. And say for a 3 hertz sampling rate, we have one more sampling interval here, and hence we are able to see that as the sampling rate decreases, we have a larger distance from the entry edge.
What is the trade-off about having a larger two probes and smaller two probes?
If the two box is really small, then we will actually miss the two box.
What if it's too large?
If it's too large, then you just want to cover a region, so you have a larger two box. You define the two box large enough to cover the entire region. There is no trade-off when you have a larger two box.
Why would you have it huge?
So, say for example, you are collecting the data on a highway and you want to cover an entire highway, then you obviously want to declare define a very large two box to cover the entire region.
So what Petra is asking is if there's no disadvantage to using a large two box, why would you not just always use a largest possible trip box and don't care about these minimum sampling rate or minimum sizes that you can use?
Okay,
not going that far to the largest possible, just use like 1 kilometer or 1 mile, because I think on a highway 1 mile is nothing, right?
Yeah, so having the larger trip boxes, if you have to take a all you care about is you want to collect the data on a highway. And if you want to automate this process, and here you want to take a, say you want to leave the highway and then you have your data collection stopping at this position. So here, when you define smaller toolbox here and a larger toolbox here, then this process, having a smaller toolbox would actually not collect the unnecessary data along this path.
So what's the usual size of a toolbox? So what's the usage of toolbox? You want to collect data, right?
Yeah.
But if you don't want to only collect one piece of data within a toolbox, right? You want to have multiple, isn't it? One does not have statistical significance anyway.
You mean like you find one trip box does not have any significance?
No, what I'm asking is what do you have in mind? What's the usual size of trip box?
So that is large enough to cover your desired path.
What are you using these trip boxes?
So we automate the process of the data collection.
If you want to collect data within the toolbox, right?
Yeah.
So that means you at least you want to have some data. Right? If you only have like one or two data points within the toolbox, it's not that useful.
Many possible applications. What we've used in just in cockpit experiment, where we had a series of parking spots and we wanted to collect data where these parking spots are.
Mm-hmm.
But since we're also collecting video data, which require a lot of storage, we didn't want to collect data in areas where there's no parking spots that we're interested in. So we deployed two boxes over these areas where data should be collected. But then you could also imagine location-based advertising applications where your cell phone is monitoring these trip boxes, and as soon as you walk in, you step into one of them, you get the Starbucks coupon or whatever is next to you. And I think for these applications, it's interesting to ask how small could you make these trip boxes? What's the minimum granularity that you
somehow, you know, what you described, you want something to tell you that you entered the box and something to tell you that you left the box.
Perfect.
Right?
So we have noisy GPS readings, and based on that, we want to detect when we enter and when we leave. We are able to trigger some other computing function, so that the going out of the apartment, so another view collecting data. Now, before we release you from the whiteboard, can you tell us a little bit more about how this sample relates to your graphing?
Yeah, so if we have lesser samples, then the distance from the entry edge is more because the successive distance between the samples also increases with the lower sample rate.
So if you have a sampling rate of 5 hertz, and you travel at 15 miles per hour,
okay,
what is the distance between two samples?
5 hertz and so we have 5 GPS samples in 1 second, and we travel at 15 miles per hour. Should be nothing but 30 meters per second. So, yeah. So we travel 30 meters in 1 second.
30 meters per second is 15 miles per hour.
Second is pretty fast.
30 meters per second, that's about 60 miles per hour.
Sorry, okay, it should be half. So 7.5.
Let's take a quarter of that.
Okay, 7.5. So we have 7.5 meters, I mean, we cover 7.5 meters in 1 second. So we have we would technically be having some 7 GPS coordinates inside the two boxes with 7.5 meters per second.
You get 7 coordinates inside the two boxes?
Yeah, with 5 points we can have 7.5. So, can you once again repeat your question? What should be the size of the two box?
So if you, I'm trying to relate that to the graph you have here.
Okay.
So how do you calculate probability from that?
Probability.
So I guess if 7.5 meters per second. And let's make it easy in terms of numbers. Let's take the 1 hertz curve, then that means you're getting 1 sample every 7.5 meters.
You would be having.
So if you have a chip box of 7.5 meters, it's very rare that you would miss that. Or if you have a chip box that's larger than 7.5 meters,
okay,
ignoring GPS deviations, you should not miss that.
Okay. So
if you look at your graph, does your result look like that?
Yeah.
Yes, it does, but the yellow curve converges around 7.5 meters.
So in case of 1 hertz, we have 1 GPS sample in 1 second, and we cover a distance of 7.5 meters, and we have just 1 GPS sample. However, in case of 5 hertz, we have 5 GPS sample across 7.5.
So in case of 5 hertz, then it should be...
So...
1.5 meters.
The width of the
trip box? Yeah, if you use a trip box larger than 1.5 meters, you could barely ever miss it.
The trip box should be 1.5 meters.
So if you look at your graph, does your results show that?
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain to me what's, you know, once you...
There is a 90% chance of...
How do we explain that?
Because of the motion of the target, the distance covered is much more than just...
I just calculated the trip motion at 15 miles per hour. You should not miss it if the distance is larger, or if the width of the trip bus is larger than 1.5 meters. Your results show that there's still some 10% chance to miss it.
Yeah.
So many
thoughts, but...
What's prevalent in crossing a trip bus? What is that?
So we calculate the probability of crossing the trip bus is what is the chance of we encounter the trip bus when we, like, we cross the, we see the trip bus when we cross.
That would be one GPS reading within the trip bus.
So like, what's the chance that we have one GPS sample inside the trip bus?
Oh, what's the probability you have? You see it when you have a sample within it?
Yes, within that region.
Somehow, why is that not deterministic?
So these data are from the collection, like...
PartNet data that we collected from.
Oh, that's the part, what we're doing.
Yeah.
Okay, so what is the, are there GPS errors that means you should have a data, but you didn't get the data? Or like you missed some GPS readings, or the GPS reading will have errors?
Yes.
So that's why it's not due to this.
The GPS readings, so this is affected when we have a horizontal error, so we cannot
see. These four lines approach 100%. At the same place, at the same distance. That's a little bit surprising, but...
That is because it also depends on the... So, where we define the trip bus, actually. So, if we have the trip bus defined here, we have a GPS coordinate for 1 hertz here, and also for the 3 hertz, we have the same GPS coordinate. And for 5 hertz, we have the same GPS coordinate. The distance is going to be the same. So it also depends on where we exactly define it.
But isn't it if you have 5 hertz, you should approach 100% much earlier with a much smaller distance?
Yes, that's what. So it also depends on the position of the trip box. Since this is calculated using the first GPS coordinate that is inside the trip box, so if we have a GPS coordinate that is contributing for the triggering of FM function, that is present in all the five GPS, I mean, for all the five sampling rate, then in that case, yeah, I do agree that most of the...
Definitely have that effect, but once you use a large amount of data, you should convert on what you're expecting.
However, we see that the 5 hertz has grown.
It has higher probability, that's true.
Yes.
So, in your case, is the car traveling at 15 miles per hour?
It travels from 0 to 30 miles per hour.
What does that mean?
So we have tested for the data samples with speed limits of 0 to 30 miles per hour.
So it's just a regular city driving pattern, and the speed of the car changes?
Yes, the speed of the car changes. This is not a constant race. It's a variable race.
And did you use one particular trip box location, or did you use multiple different locations?
I used 6 different trip box locations.
This is the all these, this graph shows all these locations combined.
Yes, yes. This is a consolidated. Finding the guard distance, we placed the GPS in a static location for 48 hours and calculated the distance of all the coordinates from our reference location. And here this graph, which has distance in meters in y-axis and timestamps in the x-axis, shows the 48-hour data that was collected. And here we have a maximum of 75 meters deviation. We also varied this reference GPS point every 1 second, 10 seconds, 60 seconds. This is because typically a car would stop in front of a stop sign for 2 seconds or in front of a signal for 60 seconds. And
so what does this mean? Does this mean if your trip box is 2.5 meters,
mm-hmm.
even if you expect a GPS reading,
mm-hmm.
but because if you look at these things, most of them are, I mean, it's very often that the error is larger than 2.5 meters.
But this is calculated from the first pixel coordinate for all the 48 hours.
So what does that mean?
So we first initialized the reference point as the first GPS coordinate for that location, and then we calculated the distance of all.
But it should, so the difference should be zero, right? If it's perfect.
Yeah, but
because
GPS has some error.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It seems the GPS error is pretty significant.
Yes.
And so if your trip box is only 2.5 meters, it's very likely that you should have a GPS reading, but you don't, because GPS error is outside the trip box. So that's why they converge at the same distance in the last line. That's what I'm saying.
But as the car is moving, we have a scenario where as the car is moving, it is not going to be traveling for 48 hours. So say considering a scenario of a very small time interval, we just got all that. So we repeated the same experiments. That's what I was about to say. We repeated the same experiment every 1 second by changing, for 48 hours, we changed this reference point every 1 second. At that time, we had most of the GPS coordinates coinciding with the zero level.
We can talk more
on repeating the experiment every 1 second, we see a probability of 95% probability of having a GPS error of 0.1 meters on changing the reference point every 1 second, and with 0.1 meters, yeah. And for 10 seconds, we have 2 meters for 95% accuracy. And 6.5 meters for 60 seconds, changing the reference point every 60 seconds. And for a total of, for having a reference point fixed, we have 10 meters of for 95% accuracy. And this shows that for a car stopping near a stop sign for 2 seconds, we might choose a car distance of about 0.5 meters, and if the car is going to stop in front of a stop line, in front of a signal for 60 seconds, then in that case we can choose a car distance of 6.5 meters. And in this, to summarize, we propose the virtual trip box technique for automating the events based on geographic location. And we demonstrated it for the data collection application. We analyzed the effects of speed of the target and sampling rate of the GPS on the dimensions of the trip box. And we see that the minimum necessary width for reliably crossing the trip box for a speed with 60 miles per hour is 28 meters, and the minimum length of the tree drops measured from the median for 99% accuracy needs to be 19 meters. And to compensate the GPS error, we used a guard distance of 8 meters and the guard time of 60 seconds to achieve 99% accuracy.